May the holy names of Jesus and Mary be blessed now and forever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same beareth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, God's providence has given us another German Franciscan this week. 2 days ago, we celebrated the feast of St. Conrad of Parsham. Today, we celebrate in the Catholic Church the great feast of St. Fidelis of Sigmaringen. St. Fidelis was just one Franciscan priest among the great tide of the Counter-Reformation in the 16th and 17th century, but he was a priest who became a martyr. He was born as Mark Ray in the town of Sigmaringen in Prussia in the year 1577 in northern Germany and raised in the Catholic faith. He earned a doctorate in philosophy in 1603 and degrees in civil and canon law in 1611. He became very famous for his expertise in the canon law. Yet over time, he became disillusioned with his career in the law. He decided he was also called, nicknamed the poor man's lawyer. Ray soon grew disgusted with the corruption and injustice he saw among his colleagues practicing law. He had always been an exceptional Catholic, an ardent Catholic, so he decided now to enter the Capuchin order and was ordained a priest in his 30s. His wealth was divided between the needy seminarians and the poor. He took the religious name of Faithful, in Latin, Fidelis. Fidelis was intelligent, disciplined, aesthetic, and committed his abundant human and spiritual gifts that were amplified and sharpened, which he put into the service into Christ the King. Having become locally well known for his fervor and holiness, Father Fidelis was now appointed by the congregation, the new congregation of the propagation of the faith in Rome, to preach, teach, and write in present day what we call Switzerland, with the goal of exhorting the people to return to embrace the Mother Church, which had given them their birth. Father Fidelis desired, as we read the martyrdom yesterday of St. George, but Father Fidelis desired this martyrdom day after day, and it soon came to him soon enough. He was appointed head of a group of Capuchins sent to preach against the Calvinists and the Zwinglians in Switzerland. And his zeal and example brought some prominent Calvinists back to the true Catholic faith. This made him the enemy of the Calvinists, who controlled much of the land. One day when traveling between two towns, he was preaching and saying and celebrating the Holy Mass. Father Fidelis was confronted along the road by Calvinist soldiers led by a minister. Fidelis had recently caused an uproar in a nearby town and had barely escaped with his life. These soldiers knew exactly who was before them. They demanded that he abandon the faith. Father Fidelis answered, "I was sent to rebuke you, not to embrace your heresy. The Catholic religion is the faith of all ages, and I do not fear death." His skull was then cracked open with the butt of a sword, his body punctured with stabs, and his left leg was hacked off in retribution for the numerous journeys he had made into this Protestant territory. Saint Fidelis then died at the young age of 45 years, 10 years after entering the religious life. He was then canonized in the year 1746. 15 years later, he was recognized as a martyr. Over 300 miracles are attributed to his intercession through his canonization process. Saint Fidelis was faithful in life and continues to intercede faithfully in death. Is our faith, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, like Saint Fidelis? How true he was even unto death. The fidelity which he vowed in baptism, he kept in all the circumstances and dangers to which he was exposed in his life. Not his youthful years at the university, nor his many years of travel all over Europe, nor all the allurement of money in his position, powerful position as a lawyer, nor human respect while he was the superior of the convent, nor danger to his life in a great pestilence, nor certain death from fanatical heretics could make him waver in the fulfillment of his duties and in his fidelity to God. He was faithful unto death. Can we not then have this lively faith of this great Capuchin saint? How can we then persevere in the faith unto death? We need to be rooted in the true vine, Jesus Christ, as we again read in the Gospel today and spoke about yesterday with Saint George. We need a firm and lively faith, together with a strong and fervent love for God as Saint Fidelis. We must look to imitate his living faith personified itself in a person. We can look at a model, this personification of lively faith. Who is this who stood at the foot of the cross with our Lord with this great faith? This personification of lively faith is no other than the Blessed Virgin Mary. Let us imitate her living faith. She followed Jesus Christ, her Son, right up until Calvary, where she acknowledged him as her Redeemer and waited in sure hope for his resurrection, for she knew surely that he would rise. She was the faith of the Church alone at this time. Her soul, Mary, free from any disturbance, persevered in her firm belief and hope that Jesus, whom she had seen die a shameful death, would rise in glory and bring the good news to his chosen people. Mary's faith, so firm in its principles and so strong in time of trials, must be our model of faith then in every circumstance. Whatever temptation, sorrow, bitterness, dryness or desolation may be inflicted upon us in these unprecedented times when the whole world appears in slow motion, in this lockdown with the virus, we must take as our model the generous, persevering hope of Mary. Look at the faith of Mary at the Annunciation. She said yes to God, and thus allowing God's plan for the salvation of souls to open up the gates of paradise, to unfold. This is the lively faith we need. Have we not got this lively faith? We read in the chapter 11 of St. Mark's Gospel, Amen, I say to you that whoever says, shall say to this mountain, Be thou removed and cast into the sea, and shall not stagger in his heart, but believe that whatsoever he saith shall be done, it shall be done unto him. Or are we, brothers, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, lukewarm in our faith? Although we have an enormous grace to be baptized Catholics and are now the new chosen race, if we do not have this living faith, we run the risk of losing out and being cast outside of God's kingdom. It is the perennial teaching of the Church that God wants all men to be saved, but we must exercise the greatest free gift given by Almighty God to us, our free will, to correspond to the graces given to us and decide yes for God. Unfortunately, many today say no and have lost their faith. This is the age of sentimentalism and Protestant mentality, especially in this country, which says that once I believe I have the faith, then I shall be saved. Jesus Christ suffered for all men, so enough for me to say yes, they say. This is true to say that Jesus accomplished all the sufferings in his violent death, but he also gives us our free will, not to do as the world wants and live a life fueled by our passions and the pleasures of life. No, our Lord wants us to share his cross and live a life of sacrifice. How do we value the cross then? Through the eyes of faith, we must believe that the crosses in life are a gift from God, and we can offer them up to heal our souls and to heal the world. We are not just a religion of faith, but we need works. We remember the Catechism, which tells us that our purpose in life is to know, to love, and to serve God, our Creator. Knowledge comes first. We can only love what we know, and the more we know, the more that we can love. Lastly, we must exercise our free will by serving God, the Creator, and making works of charity for the love of Jesus and Mary. In the mentality of the worldly Catholics on the wrong path, they say, okay, my relationship with God is personal, so there is no need with me to bother to go to Mass on Sunday. Okay, they say, I have worked hard all week. Jesus will not mind if I take my family perhaps to the beach. We can say some prayers on the way. Jesus will understand. Or perhaps they have the same mindset and say that they will stay at home or in their bedroom and say a few prayers, rushed perhaps without visiting the sacraments. This is Protestant mentality. Why? Because our faith is not based on what we feel like doing. It is, however, based on an objective truth, who is a person, Jesus Christ. He has left us the church and the commandments. The third commandment says we must honor the Sabbath. In other words, we must go to church each week in the normal circumstances of life. We must observe this commandment. Without a serious reason, this is a mortal sin to miss Holy Mass through neglect and laziness. We need to wake up, brothers and sisters in Christ, and realize that one mortal sin can send us to eternal damnation in the fires of hell, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Let us then ask our model of faith. Faith personified itself, the Blessed Virgin Mary and Saint Fidelis, this great saint today, for the grace to remain in the vine, Jesus Christ, and believe that too we can move mountains with our faith, because nothing is impossible for the Lord. Let us pray with this lively faith that very soon the doors of all the Catholic churches will be open for us all to adore God in his palace. Amen. May the holy names of Jesus and Mary be blessed now and forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.